God, praise God. Let the people of God say amen, amen. I welcome you to the Bread Broadcast, a Bible teaching program from Eternal Food Evangelistic Organization, where we edify, we exalt, and we challenge believers to the Great Commission. Here, we also call sinners to repentance through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us. Today, we are going to be talking about lameness. Lameness. It's going to be a two-part series. So we do part one today. If Jesus has not come, by next lesson, we finish it, all right? So today, it's lameness. What is it? And our case study is the lame man. That's it. That's the name it was given in the Bible. And your short reading, which is your homework, I've done mine, so you go do yours too. It's Acts chapter 3, verses 1 to 3. Acts 3, 1 to 3. And our foundation text is the gospel as written by Dr. Luke under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. Chapter 1, verse 37. Gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 1, verse 37. For with God, nothing will be impossible. Hallelujah. So, let's start this way. What is lameness? Lameness is inability to walk. What are the characteristics or aspects of lameness or attributes? Number one, no identification. The man whose short story you are going to read for your homework, he was encountered, or Peter and John encountered him at the gate called Beautiful at Jerusalem Temple. Although he must have been given a proper name by his parents, however, he was identified by his problem. You see, I couldn't give you his name because he was identified by his problem rather than his name. He became nameless, and his lameness became his identification. Please take note of that. He became nameless, and his lameness became his identification. The man was consumed with his problem than to be remotely of any help to anyone around him. Forget it. Now, bringing it to ourselves, when we become so absorbed with our problem to the point that we cannot be of help to anyone else or reach out to bless other people from our pain experience, that is living a nameless life. God has created his children to be influencers. Let me say that again. God has created his children to be influencers. This does not mean, please listen carefully, it does not mean that we all are going to have famous jobs or ministries. No. The type and size of jobs or ministries that each believer we have is totally dictated by God. You have no choice over what you're going to do. I have no choice. God tells us, this is the plan I have for you. That's it. All I have to do, all you have to do, is walk in God's plan. So he decides the type of your ministry or the type of your job and the size of your job or ministry. But every disciple of Jesus has been equipped to make impacts in the lives of others around us. to fail to impact others, listen up, is to live a life of no identification, which is characteristic of lameness. Let's go to Hebrews 13:16. Hebrews 13:16. But do not forget to do good and to share, for with such sacrifices, God is well pleased. What did God say over Jesus when he was baptized in the Jordan and he came up? He said, "This is my beloved son, in whom I'm well pleased." You see, on the mountain of transfiguration, what did he say? This is my beloved begotten son, in whom I'm well pleased. Hear him. You see, why did God declare that over Jesus? Because Jesus gave his life and lived a life of sacrifice. That is why we still talk about him today, not only as our friend, not only as our big brother, but also as our savior. Think of all the false religions of the world. How many of their gods, their idols really, died for their followers? None, you see. So as a child of God, you cannot live any life less than that of Christ. You have to make impact in the lives of others. That is how your name continues in the memory of mankind. One soul is a big ministry in God's dictionary. You may be saying, "Justin Zion, the kind of job or assignment or ministry God has given me is in the backside of an African country or in Tora Bora in Afghanistan. Nobody is going to know me." Listen, if that's the assignment God has given you, or "I'm just a stay-at-home mom," you are not just anything. Oh no, you have a great ministry. You know why? Because a great ministry in the kingdom of God equals one soul. If you are able to touch one soul, God says, "She did a great job." That's a big ministry. One soul is a big ministry in God's dictionary. Moving on. Another aspect or characteristic of lameness is stagnation. The lame man was stuck in one spot. He could not see himself without those who carried him daily to drop him at the temple's gate, where he would be begging for money. The timetable of his helpers, the people that would carry him, dictated his daily movement. The lame man had buried his life in the lives of others. Listen, we all need help. I don't know about you, but I need help. Okay? I need help from God. I need God's help through people. As you can see, the program you are watching is through the help of somebody who is recording that you're able to see me. You see, I don't know what to do with the camera if my life depended on it. You see, it's through the help of another person that the post-production of this program will be done. I don't know what to do with it. You see, so we all need help. Listen up. But to put my hope in another human instead of God is to set up for a life of stagnation. The lame man could have learned a trade. Oh yeah. He's not blind. No. So his case really was not as bad as the blind Bartimaeus. Yet, when Jesus was passing by, the Bible says, blind Bartimaeus removed his garment when Jesus called him. He was ready to run and he was blind, you see. So this lame man could have learned a trade. Even if he would need help to buy materials for his work and to move things around, in the end, he would have been able to do something profitable with his hand, you see. Listen up. This is where it now concerns us. A believer whose life is stuck should check their spiritual state first. Don't look out and say, maybe it's my boss, it's my husband or my wife. No, if your life is stuck as a Christian, check your spiritual life first. Why? Because your spiritual life, my spiritual life, controls my natural life, your natural life, okay? Our spiritual life controls our natural life. If there is a stagnation, we need to check if our prayer life is up and running, if our Bible study life is alive, if our obedience to the Word of God is complete. If you obey the Word of God halfway, it's not going to work for you. Forget it. So check if your obedience to the Word of God is complete. And lastly, but not in any way the least, if your circle of associates, if it's godly, who are your companions? Who are your inner circle, your friends? Are they godly people? God will only supply helps where and when we need. But to rely on human help as a mode of sustenance rather than God brings stagnation, which is another aspect of lameness. Let's go to the book of Jeremiah, chapter 17, verse 5. We are going to be reading from New Living Translation. Jeremiah 17, 5. This is what the Lord says. This is the Lord speaking, not just up in Zion. Cursed. Cursed are those who put their trust in mere humans, who rely on human strength and turn their heart away from the Lord. You see, a wonderful brother, dear brother, was sharing a couple of times or more how some of his relatives, they will call him and they want him to help them, to lift their hands up. I need this, I need that. You know, like, he's God. And he said, I told them, listen, did I tell you my name was Jesus? I'm not God. Look up to God for help. Because I myself am looking up to God to help my life, you see. That's an intelligent man, you see. So if your hope is in, oh, if I talk to so-and-so, don't worry, it'll fix me up. She'll fix me up. There's no problem. If my mama hears about it, listen, you better put your hope in God so you will not be disappointed. Because if you are a Christian and you always put your hope in man, God will allow you to be disappointed. Oh yeah, on purpose. He will allow those people to betray you or disappoint you so you can come back to your real source of hope, God. So to hope in God is to hold to God. Let's say that again, so beautiful. To hope in God is to hold to God. So we have talked about no identification as one of the characteristics of lameness. We've talked about stagnation. Now let's talk about starvation. Remember, we are finishing this next week. This lame man would starve if he didn't beg for money. Why? That's because he had conditioned his life to that lifestyle. Listen, he had defined his own life and confined his own life. You may have enough food in your kitchen pantry to eat. Praise God. However, you can still starve of God's plan of increase and enlargement for your life if you don't have the right mindset. A stuck mindset will produce starvation to every potential growth and expansion that God may have planned for you. Your life goes into the decline, mode, the moment you believe or you agree with others that you have reached the pinnacle of whatever you are doing. And there were so many examples that jumped at me on this at this point. Eventually, I had to remove all of the examples because of time. But there was the particular case of a lady that really struck me. That was like, it's over 10 years ago, over a decade. And she came to me sad and all that. And I said, what happened to you? And she said, one of my relatives said I'm too stupid to go to college. And I said, he said that? Oh yeah. So I looked to my side, there was my Bible, English Bible. So I grabbed it. And this individual is not a native English speaker. So I gave her my Bible, my English Bible, and I said, open anywhere and read it. And she did. And I said, you just read the Bible in English. That tells me you are literate, you know how to read, number one, and you are bilingual because you are not a native English speaker. It's your second language. I said, that tells me you are not stupid. You drive, don't you? Yeah, I do. That takes a lot of coordination and intelligence to drive. So I said, you are not stupid. So this lady came later and said, I want to further my education. And she went to the local community college and she did well. By the time I heard, the last time I heard about this individual, she had finished a college degree, you see. Now, if that individual, if this lady had agreed with her relative that said she was too stupid, that expansion of promotion of going to college to get a degree would have been starved to death, you see. Or if you are your own enemy and you are saying, this is how far I can go. Now I've got to the level I set up in my mind to be my apex, and I'm there now, then you're shooting yourself in the foot. Because God's plan for his children, it's limitless. So we need to swap self-ambition for God-ambition. When we begin to ask the right questions, like Saul of Tarsus, on his way, when God converted him on his way to Damascus, and he said, God, what would you have me do, you see? When we begin to ask that kind of a question, we will see that there is no stopping us until God is done with us. Listen, well done, good and faithful servant, is not going to be spoken to you as a child of God on this side of eternity. No. Why? Because God is never done with his children on this side. Oh no. He keeps working in us. He keeps showing his glory through us, you see. That is why well done, good and faithful servant, is spoken when we get home, you see. A mind that sets limits that lead to starvation or potential promotion is another aspect of lameness. A mind that sets limits that lead to starvation or potential promotion is another aspect of lameness. Joshua 13:1. The book of Joshua 13 verse 1. Now Joshua was old and stricken in years, which means he's advanced in age. And the Lord said unto him, thou art old and stricken in years, and there remaineth yet very much land to be possessed. You see, God is always saying to his children, there remaineth yet much land to be possessed. God will never say, oh yeah, you've reached your limit, that's it. Only if you're a sinner, a day will come, God will say, I've had enough of that madness. I've been trying to tell you I can save you, but you keep hurling insult at my face. Now, for a sinner, there's a limitation. One day God will say, that's enough. I've had enough. But for a child of God, God is never saying, God never says enough for his children when they are doing what he has asked them to do, when they are being what he has asked them to be. That's why we will receive well done when we get home. You see that everything I told you when you were over there, you did it. Well done. Good job, you see. Let's go to the gospel according to John chapter 14, verse 12. John 14, 12. This is Jesus himself speaking. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, that is on Jesus, the works that I do, shall he do also, or she do also. And greater works than these shall he or she do, because I go unto my Father. Listen, Jesus fed people miraculously. Jesus converted so many people, preaching about the gospel. Jesus healed the sick. I mean, listen, you want to tell me you've done much as Jesus? Huh? If your answer is no, then dust yourself off. We've got what to do, all right? No limitation. We've got what to do. We have a kingdom to build for our Father. All right, so there is no setting a barrier or a limit that this is how far I can go in this field. As long as you are where God has put you to be, who told you you can rise up that God cannot promote you to become the president of your company? Huh? Who told you that? You say, I don't have enough education. Says who? Huh? To set up your standard is to seal up God's grand plan. To set up your own standard is to seal up God's grand plan. Don't. So, what have we done so far? What is lameness? Lameness is the inability to walk. What are the characteristics or aspects of lameness? Number one, no identification. This is the failure to make impact in the lives of other people. Stagnation. This is to rely on others for sustenance rather than on God. Starvation. This is to have a limiting mindset. Now, please listen carefully. The real lameness in life is not physical. No. If you are lame in your feet, you are not lame. Oh no. The real lameness is not physical, is not financial, is not marital, psychological, or emotional. No. The real lameness in life is that of the soul, you see. If you are a believer and you think you are lame in any area of your life, look no further than your spiritual life, right? The real lameness is on the inside. You wouldn't have searched long before you know where the wall cracked. Repent of whatever the Holy Spirit shows you and begin to do things God's way, all right? Every progress without Jesus at the heart of it, forget it. You forget it. It's going to bring you back down to ground zero. So start doing things God's own way. If you are an unbeliever, your life has been in a fix up to now. Say what? That's kind of rude. No, it's not. Let me say that slowly. All right? Stay with me. If you are an unbeliever, you don't believe in the Jesus of this Bible that I'm talking about, your life has been on hold in a fix. You want to know why? I'm going to tell you. The progress that you think you have made so far, oh, look at the house I built. What is this lady saying? That my life is in a fix. Look at my house. Look at the job I have. Look at the car I drive. Listen up. The progress that you think you have is not the kind of progress that counts forever, so it's useless. Your car is premature junkyard resident. Your house is premature rubble. Okay? So come back, let's talk. Whatever progress that you have that has no Jesus in it is riddled with spiritual sickness. It's a leprous soul. The malignancy of the soul is the failure to accept Jesus. You see, everything you said you've achieved is nothing. You know why? Because you have refused to receive Jesus into your life. So you are really sick. But God can heal you, you see. Your failure to accept Jesus is the unpardonable sin. Say what? Yes, says the Bible. You see, a mass murderer will make it to heaven if he receives Jesus. Oh yeah. A prostitute is going to be a colorful gathering. I'm telling you. You thought I was born this way? You must be kidding. I was a big time sinner. But I received Jesus into my life. And then he turned my life around. You see? So to fail to accept Jesus is to tell God that you are perfect. Are you ready to go there? Huh? You're perfect? It is to believe that your own goodness can bring you to God's holy heaven. That is an argument any decent, intelligent, sane person will dare not make. You want to tell God you're perfect? Huh? You want to tell God that? I know you are intelligent, of course. You are sane. I know. So you dare not come up with that really nonsensical argument that I'm perfect. No. Eternal hell burning with literal fire awaits everyone who dies without Christ. No one starts to exist after they die. No. Any religion that tells you you go into a state of nothingness, they're lying to you. They want to take you to hell. It's a lie. Your soul, my soul, never dies. When you die, listen, this is what's going to happen. Let me tell you about the future. Your soul will be able to see. You'll be able to hear. You'll be able to you'll be thirsty, and you will even remember things. You will remember the way I'm speaking to you. You will. How do you know this, lady? Josephine Zion, how do you know this? Go read the Gospel of Luke, chapter 16, 19 to 31, and I've asked that Bible verse be put up, because I want everybody to go read it. Luke 16, 19 to 31. Look for any Bible in your language. Go read it. Jesus himself said it. And it's not a parable. It's not an anecdote. It's not a figment of imagination. It's a real story of something that happened that Jesus told us. Imagine burning forever and not dying. That is what awaits everyone who scoffs at the gift of salvation in Jesus. Listen, I know I've been sounding like a bad news carrier for you, but here's the good news. God didn't make hell for you. Oh no, your name is not Satan. Oh no, God loves you. God made hell for the devil and his angels. And you are not the devil. You may be a sinner, and you are a sinner if you don't give your life to Jesus, but you are still not Satan. So you are not the candidate for hell. God wants you to turn over your life to Jesus. That is how you change your candidacy from hell to heaven. You see, he wants to unshackle you from every demon that has made your life lame until now. You don't have to go to hell. It's not made for you. No. So don't scoff at this preaching. I'm begging you, please, do not. Don't go to hell with the devil. Let the devil go alone. You are not the one giving people cancer, are you? You are not the one giving people kidney problems, health problems. Why should you go with the devil? That's not smart, is it? That's stupid. Let the devil go. You come to Jesus. It doesn't matter what you have done. He will forgive you. If you are ready, I'm going to say a quick prayer. And a page is coming up. Click on that link and go to where it takes you. We meet you there, all right? Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for the gift of liberty and freedom in Christ Jesus that we have received. We pray, oh Lord, that you help us to put this gift to a good use. And Lord, anywhere where we could have broken the hedge, we ask that you forgive us and give us the grace to do things your own way so that our lives can move forward. And for those going to want to know Jesus' faith, Father, I pray, open their eyes, meet with them, and help them, O Lord, as they make decision for you. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen. I will see you next week. We finish this next week, all right? If Jesus tarries. If Jesus has not split the sky open.